Good morning. Welcome to 1 Million Cups Kansas City. If you want to grab your coffee and come take a seat, we'll get started. Travis. So once again, good morning and welcome to 1 Million Cups. My name is Courtney. I'm one of your community organizers, along with Kyle, Luke, Tyler, Casey, and Zach. So thank you for joining us. We are a weekly entrepreneurial program. We have two companies that present for 6 minutes, and then we open it up to the Q&A with our expert panel first, and then to the audience. So if you have a question, please raise your hand and we will come around with a mic. I will ask our expert panel to introduce themselves to us first.
If I can actually get the mic to work. Hi, I'm Melissa Roberts. I work at the Enterprise Center in Johnson County. I'm so pleased to be here today. To kick off Women's History Month, right? Yeah, so on our all-lady panel, this is wonderful. So the Enterprise Center in Johnson County is a 20-year-old nonprofit organization that helps connect entrepreneurs across the city, no matter where you live, to the resources that you need to grow your businesses. And so we do that through education and shameless plug. We have a workshop happening tomorrow on business valuation, if you're interested. We do that through mentoring, and we do that through providing connections to capital through the Mid-America Angels Investment Network and the Women's Capital Connection.
Good segue, Melissa. So I'm Kelly Pruneau with the Women's Capital Connection. We are a women's angel investment group of 45 investors that invest in women-led ventures. We co-invest with Mid-America Angels. The Women's Capital Connection is part of an alliance called 1KC for Women that encompasses Women's Capital Connection, Women's Employment Network, Women's Business Center, and a new program we have called We Lend, which is a micro-lending program. And we do have a workshop, too, and I put some information back there. It's called Primed for Growth. It's a great opportunity we're doing with the Kauffman Foundation and AltCap for men and women, and it's actually for if you are in business and really want to get a grasp on financial statements. So anyway, it's back in the back, some information.
Great, thank you. And yes, we are celebrating Women's History Month at 1 Million Cups this month. 3 out of the 5 weeks, we have women presenters as well as women on our panel each week for 5 weeks. So it is going to be an exciting month. So we will get started with our first presenter. I would like to welcome Jesse Stone with Lube Linens.
Okay, can everyone hear us chatting over here? Okay. Hi, guys.
Hi.
So I'm Jesse Stone from Lude Linens. And my friend over here is going to be manning my clicker because I'm not good at computers and I couldn't make the pictures. See? Look at that magic. Okay, so Lude Linens is my homegrown business of edgy housewares for fun people. You can check out my display in the back by the coffee there. I started Lude Linens last year when I found myself kind of restarting my life from scratch. So there I was crying into my Indian food with a good friend of mine and saying, I don't know how I'm going to support my family. And she said, well, you're an artist. What's your best seller? And I said, well, they're these hand-stitched tea towels that I like hand-stitch intricate curse words into. And I have calluses from stitching so many curse words. I can't possibly stitch any more than I already make. And she said, well, why don't you print them? And I said, no, you don't understand. It's an art, and it's the juxtaposition of the hand-stitching and the curse words that makes it so special. And she said, I really think you're overvaluing your art. and I was like, yeah, she might be right. So I spent like almost a year kind of creating a whole line of hand-painted. I all started out as a painter, so I made hand-painted designs that look hand-stitched but can be printed. So now I have scalability, which I learned is a really important business word. And that's how Lude Linens was born. So I'm going to roll the movie here. So now I'd just like to throw up a little, this is my first video from my first Kickstarter, which is how I funded my first line of printed towels. And this will kind of give you an idea of the feel of our business. Any minute now. That's my son, Solace. That's his eyeball there.
Story of creation of Lude Linens. Story of my life.
it's not. It's not up. Hang on. I'll just give you some background while this is coming up. So I'm from Springfield, Missouri. Was actually born here in Kansas City, so I'm sort of a native. I lived in Lee Summit when it was the country. I had a dog that joined a pack of coyotes. So that used to happen in Lee Summit. Sorry, I should have also mentioned that computers can smell my fear.
Here we go. We see it on the screen.
If that's it, yep.
Still not have any audio, but hold the microphone up to the speaker.
Well, that and of course, Steven. Finally overthrowing the government of Babylon and surviving the. The story of the creation of lewd linens is the story of my life. Growing up in a secluded religious community, I learned early on that my future would consist of women's work. Well, that and of course, violently overthrowing the government of Babylon and surviving the coming apocalypse. It was that kind of church. To obey my elders, I learned to cook, sew, stockpile food, and tend to babies. This all made me very happy. So when I was 21, while all my peers were drinking their way into adulthood, I joined the Amish. It was beautiful. I milked cows, drove buggies, learned to cook on a wood stove, and lived my life by candlelight. I pumped my water by hand, tried to speak German, and rocked a bonnet like nobody's business. Nevertheless, in my quiet moments, I began again to find myself still wanting more. My inner spark grew into a flame, and I began to buck the rules. About 100 miles away and 5 more miles down a dirt road, I found what I thought might be destiny. A real live commune. Fully equipped with miles of rolling wooded hills, enough curry to flavor your lentils for life, and 100 sometimes naked people to fight, love, work, and live with. It was heaven on earth in a whole new way. I worked in the garden till my fingers looked like earthworms. I made peanut butter and wove hammocks with 20 of my closest friends. I swam naked in the creek, dressed from a pile of communal clothes, and ate my dinner at crowded picnic tables while persimmons fell into my soup. Oh, and I learned to curse like a sailor. It was a beautiful season of life. When the world shifted and life changed again, I found myself once more living on the mainstream world, loving life with my 2-year-old son, our 2 dogs, and our 2 cats. I had a lot of great stories, but no great job references. Everyone always tells you, do what you love. So, to pay the bills, I went back to my roots and started hand-stitching dish towels with my favorite phrases from down on the commune. Lewd Linens was born, and they've been growing ever since. With the help of a printing press and you out there in Kickstarter land, we are ready to take Lewd Linens to the next level. By printing our original designs, we will be able to create a piece of art that retains its beauty and sense of fun while also being affordable and accessible to many more people. We are so excited about this project, and we can't wait to share our love of the wholesomely dirty with you.
Thank you.
Sorry about that.
No, that's cool. Okay, so that's kind of our scene. So so that was our first Kickstarter video. It funded for $5,000 last year, and I printed my first batch of designs, which sold pretty well. I'm sure that'll figure itself out. I learned a lot about business and production since then. I started out silkscreen, and I've since switched to heat pressing because it allows me a lot more versatility in color and design. I added pillows and wall art to my line this year, and this next year I'll be adding mugs and hats as well. So last fall I added a whole wholesale line, so I did a new line of 30 new designs that don't have any curse words or reference to sexual preference in them, and so they can be sold at any store because I'm trying to make my stuff more accessible to other people. So I have both my lines out there displayed. I have my wholesale like clean line, and then if you want to see my little catalog of the more fun stuff, it's out there as well. So then this past fall, I also just wrapped up my second successful Kickstarter that funded for $3,000, which was creating my Saucy Sampler, which I'm super excited about. It's out there as well. The Saucy Sampler is my new adult coloring book. So it's made to look like the old like hand-stitched samplers from colonial days, if like Nicki Minaj and NWA were doing the stitching on those. So that kind of brings you up to where we are today. Going forward, I'm really working right now on moving into the wholesale market because I feel like this is a great way for my business to have kind of a steady income base, but also to give a lot more national exposure to my line, which is really what it needs because, as I mentioned, I live in Springfield, Missouri. So the people who live in Springfield and like my stuff like me, but they are fully saturated. So it really it needs to go outside of my town for sure. To that end, I've just registered for a buyer's market in Dallas, Texas this spring. This is kind of where shops from all over the country and in all over the nation or all over the world come to shop for their next line, like everything that they're going to be carrying in their store for the next season. So it's a pretty big shebang. This is a week-long event. It's kind of massive, and it's the kind of thing that could take my fledgling business up to the next several levels if I can make it happen. The price tag for that is about $5,000, and I just spent my last $20 driving here. So I made a GoFundMe account that you all are welcome to please share and feel free to fund if you're just in the mood for that. And I'm such a Luddite that I just made it on this poster because I don't know how to put it into the slideshow, which wouldn't have mattered anyway, as it turns out.
We don't know how computers work either.
Right, right. You guys are my peeps, for sure. So here's my GoFundMe if anybody wants to send me over to do some wholesaling in Dallas, which I'm going to make happen. So I'm working on that. Also, in the future, I would love to see Lude Linens being sold through something larger like Target, obviously my clean version, or Urban Outfitters, who could do any of my designs. I really feel like Urban Outfitters understands me. So also, I would love to be able to send my towels and my coloring books and everything that I'm making right now to the celebrities that I feel like I would get it. So if any of you guys could contact Ellen DeGeneres or Jimmy Kimmel or Stephen Colbert, that would be great because I don't know them. So I'm hoping one of you does. Also, I think that my whole line would be really fun to just launch out in my own little reality show because I've also invented a new sports team I call Fancy Ball that goes along with my whole line, which I can explain later if you want me to. I'll just explain it since I said I'd go a little long. It's where you dress so fancy that it's prohibitive to a sport, and then you play a sport. We're just going to rotate what the sports are. I'm pretty excited about that, and that's a kind of in cohesion with my branding, so it's pretty fun.
I think I can help you out with that. Just if you need some help.
I really
with sports.
Want there to be a Kansas City League because Springfield isn't that far away. So we could meet in Clinton and just have epic fancy ball battles. Okay, get in touch with me. Okay, so that's pretty much it. As I was saying, I would love for that to be a reality show as well. So if any of you guys know any of the Real Housewives, I feel like I can really scrap. So you can send those girls my way. So
let's give an uncensored round of applause for Lude Linens. We're going to open it up to our expert panel.
Okay, so hi. I love the funny sayings and stuff. We have some kind of serious business questions for you.
All right, I'm going to do my best. I'm learning.
Yeah, absolutely. So I think what I find really interesting about what you've done is you've utilized a couple of platforms that I think people often look to as an option when they're starting their own business. So Kickstarter, I saw you were on Etsy and you do a lot of sales there. Can you talk about how you've used those platforms to grow your business, pros and cons for others in the audience who might be looking at those as an option?
Sure. So Etsy is a really glutted market. I mean, I've done Etsy for however long Etsy's been around now, and it's as a passive income, it just kind of hangs out there with the other 8 million users. But I like Etsy because, as I mentioned, I'm super bad with computers, so I'm able to have a pretty basic website and then just let it send my customers to Etsy for all of their buying needs, and Etsy's really useful for that. Also, I've learned how to make it more my my page on Etsy more searchable. So now when people go to Etsy, they can search my phrases and they come up pretty well. So that's really useful for Etsy. Kickstarter, I think, is really great. I didn't use Kickstarter to fund my projects at all. Someone told me early on that you go into a Kickstarter knowing how you will fund it, so that you know, so that it's, you're going to get, because Kickstarter, I don't know if you know, is all or nothing. If you ask for $5,000 and you make $4,999, you don't get anything. So you have to know that you'll be able to cover whatever little window. So anyway, it did fund, and that was really wonderful. But what I used it for is that it was a way for me to make like some really cute videos. I'd love for you guys to go check out my second Kickstarter video, because it's got someone tipping at a strip club with a bunch of my coloring book pages, like making it rain. So it's worth checking out. But I got to make these really fun shareable videos, and people shared my Kickstarter because they liked the videos. And then it got me a bigger customer base. That's really, I liked Kickstarter for that. It secondarily funded my projects.
So in my former life, before I did or do what I do, I'm a retailer. So I own four different retail businesses.
Awesome.
For 18 years. I have the scars to prove it to everybody. Okay. Anyway, so my question is this. It's all about you. You're a great brand. That was an awesome presentation. You did a nice job. You really did. And you're your brand.
Yes,
but,
that's what people keep telling me.
Distribution is where I'm like wondering about.
Do you mean like ability to make enough or
ability?
Or?
Yeah, to get it out there and to get it out to. Well, make enough, I think you can probably, hopefully, get that figured out. I mean, that's a nice problem to have, but
right.
But no, it's really distributing through reps or through, you know, to take on your line as part of their line. I don't know. I'm really challenged on how you're funding this. I mean, this is really just bits and pieces this thing needs. Anytime you have inventory, you have to fund it in a much bigger way.
Right.
But I'm kind of just looking and asking you about what are your distribution channels and what's coming up for you.
So partly I need to ask you those questions. luckily I grew up in abject poverty, so I really know how to do things at a really, really low budget. I've always been a self-employed artist. I've always known how to just be like, oh, look, I found these 3 grains of rice and I made them into this thing and then I sold it and then I got $10 and I bought a better thing. Like, that's kind of, so like, I'm not gonna have a storefront. My cost of creating my towels is low because I make them all myself. I've got the equipment to do it myself. I have people that I can kind of force into limited amounts of labor for me. So as far as my initial cost goes, yes, there's still a cost, and yes, it's still daunting, and I wasn't being funny when I said I used the last of my money for gas money. I'm really struggling, for sure. And the little bits of money that I have, like right now I'm getting ready for the festival circuit where I sell all year long, so I'm putting out $1,000 in festival fees for all the places I plan to go then for the year. I'm just learning about the channels for breaking into like store wholesales, which is what I would like to be doing. So that's why I'm working with the buyer's market, because my understanding is I used to sell at some art galleries, and I contacted those owners and asked them where they went for their buying, and they all go to this Dallas market. So I went and checked out the Dallas market. It's like thousands of dollars for a 10 by 10 booth, but it's where everyone goes, and I don't know the channels. Like having a rep, I don't know how that works.
Can you, for this particular thing, can you talk to somebody who has a booth there, maybe even a permanent, or, you know, I don't know how that particular market works, mm-hmm. but, and just ask them for some space within their booth? I mean, I don't know. That might be a thought, because 5,000, that's, you know, to go
hotel,
spend, that's
but
putting
yeah.
all, but that's putting all your eggs in one basket there,
it
too.
It certainly is. Yeah.
I'm not so sure you don't go just scout it out first, spend some money traveling there,
mm-hmm.
because also if you set a booth up like that, then yeah, be careful what you wish for. All of a sudden you sell so much and you can't.
Yeah, I did
you
a
know,
little groundwork
get
on getting ready
okay.
for that. Like I called the supplier for my towel and the supplier for my heat transfer paper. I did the math on how I would have to hire out some people doing a little bit of the creating for me, assuming that I sold say 10,000 towels. and it's edgy. And I called the buyer's market and asked like kind of what the expected turnaround is, and they said about a month is kind of an expected turnaround for like ordering to getting the product to them. So I feel like if I didn't sleep for a month, I could make that happen.
I think it's important for you to get some of these processes in place.
Sure.
You know, that you can, yeah, because you'll get to the point where you can't make all these. And so then it's, yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, to just get some of those processes in place, I think.
Yeah. But the other thing is I don't know how to find every little tiny boutique. I can't Google cool boutiques who would like my tea towels. And I don't know how to find all those millions of stores in all the millions of towns that would resonate with my product otherwise. So I would love to know how to do that, because I would love to not spend $5,000. Still, feel free to go to the GoFundMe.
All right, we're going to go ahead and open up to the crowd now. We got one in the middle.
Good morning.
Hi.
the line looks good. Your product looks good back there. The problem I saw right off the bat was you're probably not going to get these all in Target and Walmart because of what they are. But have you considered eBay? I mean, I've got some friends that do a lot of selling on eBay, and you just sit there and the orders come in. And you could sell basically anything, words or not. So that may be some way for you to look into expanding your business. As long as, I don't know if you could go a month before filling an order, but.
Oh, I wouldn't on a small order, yeah.
But that could be a way to grow your business, and you never need a storefront.
Yeah, no, I haven't looked at eBay. I'll look at it.
Got one over here on your left.
Are you using any other social media channels to help promote stuff, and have you tried any paid advertising on any of those?
A tiny bit. I do have a Facebook page, and I do have an Instagram, which someone at the Springfield Million Cups just sat me down and explained to me what Instagram was, so that's kind of how good I am at social media. But I do try to keep those pages active. I post on them a couple of times a week, and they are pretty well responded to, but I have a lot to learn in that. So yeah, if you go to Facebook, I'm Lude Linens on Facebook, and if you go to Instagram, I'm Lude Linens on Instagram. Yes, he just, I don't even understand what Twitter is, but apparently there's already a Lude Linens there. I know it's a big thing. I just don't get it. But
have you run any paid on your Facebook?
A little bit, but there's such targeted advertising for it, which is awesome, and I don't quite know how to do my targeting, so I'm learning. I've done a little bit, and I've gotten good responses with it, yeah. But I need to learn more. Thank
Question
you.
Over to your right here.
First, first off, I think your product's really good, and keep up the good work. Two questions that I have. First off, have you sold your products in like the 6 state regions surrounding Springfield, Missouri, like Kansas, Missouri, like Kansas City, St. Louis? The first question I have is, how are you selling in Dallas, Texas, or how could you sell in Dallas if you can't sell in Kansas City or St. Louis or places within a 100-mile radius of Springfield?
Right. No, I'm not selling in those places because I don't know how to find and approach the stores. That's my big hang-up there. The reason I'm able to sell in Dallas is because it's a buyer's market. You rent a booth for a week, and you've paid for your booth, and you sell there. So it's a different setup.
They do have some setups. They do have some stuff like that in Kansas City. So you could probably look into that as potential, because in one, you could save money and you can make more money on the profits on the long run. And I'm thinking, okay, Dallas, why would she go to Dallas, which is a flight, when you can drive up to Kansas City? It's like $20 on gas.
Right.
But that's what I'm thinking.
I'm interested in Dallas because stores are coming there to buy their inventory, so I'm interested in that. But I do want to know more about the Kansas City market. Like, I vend at the Springfield Farmers Market every weekend, so I would love to be in other places for sure. Yeah, okay. So I would like to know more about the Kansas City market and which is the good place to go.
And the next question I have, and I do apologize for asking too many questions, what's your, so what was like the turnaround time from the, when did you guys start becoming very profitable?
Any day now. Actually, honestly, as soon as I put out my Kickstarter and started selling my printed towels, it just made them more affordable and more accessible to people, and it did take off right away. I did right away have a business that people started recognizing and selling and sharing and buying from, and that's nice, but it's certainly not feeding me. But yeah.
Another question
Yeah.
What a great way to kick off Women's History Month.
Thanks.
I hope that means you'll go down in history.
Yeah, well, one way or another.
it's clear that it's you, yourself, and nobody else really working on this project except for the
me.
Forced labor you talked about.
Right, that's my forced labor right there. She's videoing this.
Yeah. So congratulations on being able to present here.
Thank you.
Because I think this is a great opportunity for you to make a lot of business friends.
I hope so.
Who can help fill in some of the spaces that maybe need to be filled to help you understand how to do this as effectively as possible. Because the thing I worry about is that you're going to get to burnout before you can get successful. So you might want to listen carefully to all the people who are willing to work with you for free, because I know you spent your last $20. So nobody here should be going up to you and trying to sell you their services.
Thank you for that announcement.
But there's a lot. But I think there's a lot of people who can actually help you. You seem to be a pretty adept thinker, and you just need to figure out how to leverage yourself in the most efficient way. I too have some concerns about Dallas, only because of the kind of energy it will take for you to do that, and where you will end up. I'm not saying that it's going to be unsuccessful, but hopefully you're thinking about all the steps that take you there. You need to also think about what steps by going for the Dallas option you might be closing yourself off from, because there's only so much of you and you can't work them all simultaneously. So it's more comments than a question, and I wish you the best.
Thank you. I would like to just say, kind of off of what you just said, like, it is true that I have a lot to learn, and that you're right, I am just one person and I am figuring all of this out. And I kind of grew up in a cult, as my video mentioned, and then I lived with the Amish, and then I lived in communes, and I was in foster care for a while. Like, I don't really know. When I went to college, I had to walk onto a college campus and just ask people how to enroll in the school. And I was an A student, but I don't know how things work out here. And so I really am, it's a steep learning curve for me. But I have always had to learn things pretty quickly, and I do okay. But you're right, there's a lot.
Question here in the back.
I love your authenticity. Can you tell us a little bit about your buyers and the psychology behind their buying decision?
Yeah, what I've noticed so far, and again, this is stuff that I'm learning, but I definitely have two really kind of large buying groups, and they're pretty clearly defined. One is kind of like women who are kind of my age and a little bit older, who really, I think, they're more mainstream kind of business type women, and I think that they really like, I think they feel boxed in, and I think they like any little thing that's like, hey, have you seen my tea towel? I don't just live in this box, right? Like, I think they really like that little bit of edge. They're probably the people who like my stuff the most. And then the other is kind of like I mentioned, like the Urban Outfitter, like younger, like, we love everything that's crazy. And they like two different things. Like, one kind of likes my cleaner line that's edgy, and one likes, you know, my line that has like the F-bomb on it. So those are my two. Like, lots of people like my things, and I have like a lot of LGBT positive and woman positive stuff that, you know, other people like. But those are kind of my two big crowds. Great. And they seem to hang out a lot.
Great. Hi, Jesse. I love, love, love your creativity. And I also love that you know what you don't know. And I wonder, since you grew up in a commune, if maybe it's time for you to take on a business partner, and then that, even if it requires equity, because you know you have to learn all these things, and you're sitting in a room of business people, it is a long process. And I'm just wondering if you've ever thought about that.
Yeah, actually, when I did my last Million Cups, someone asked me that. And so I've spent this time actually seriously pondering that. And the answer is yes. I think that a business partner would help me grow so much more exponentially than I can myself, that I would be gaining money, not losing it, by sharing equity. I really do. But again, like I don't have a bunch of lawyer friends to advise me on this. Like, my connections can make you like really good hemp jewelry. So I'm learning, but yes, I'm quite open. I'm interested in that.
Well, there are many areas in the United States of America where hemp jewelry
Perfect.
Another question in the back here.
Yeah. Kudos to you. It seems like you have a very innate sense of your market without maybe having that background. But similar to this question, have you considered looking into different accelerators for your product and your business? Because it seems like you've got something that the creativity is solid and your market seems to be there, that the application of a little more experience, technology, and capital altogether might really make it boom.
Thank you. Yeah, I have applied for one accelerator, and actually I made it to the final little set of like five people interviewing, and I didn't make it because they only went with tech businesses, and they said my business just can't be as scalable as a tech business, which is definitely true. And then I was so sad I never applied again. So you're right, I need to look into that. I am just one girl, and I am physically making my product and creating, like, I'm making a new towel right now that says, "Catch me outside, how about that?" So so I'm kind of always trying to keep my stuff on edge. So I am constantly making and selling to kind of like be buying groceries and heat. But I yes, you're right, I need to look more into the, would I just Google accelerator programs or? Okay, I'll ask these people. Thank you for encouraging me to do that.
Toss your hands in the air and we will come around to you. We got a few more minutes for questions. No, we don't? Luke's saying no.
No, we got time for him. Right?
Got time for you.
That guy.
There you go.
Hi, not really a question, but just perhaps advice. You mentioned going to not knowing which boutiques to go into or how to approach them. Go through the front door. They're small business owners just like you, and they would want to have probably more than 50% of the time want to have that conversation. Also, as a first-year entrepreneur myself, you spend more time figuring out what you don't know.
Yeah.
And so the next day, you've learned something that can push you forward past the next thing that you don't know.
Yeah.
So knock on the front door. Any town that you're traveling to has a dozen boutiques.
Right.
Go in and have the conversation and see what works.
Okay.
Good luck.
Thank you. Yeah, they're always in my car to mop up spills.
All right. Let's hear it. Give a round of applause, everybody. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Do I get this
cup? Oh, yeah, you get one of those.
Man, I've seen people with these, and I really wanted one, so thank you. All right.
Thank you.
So we're going to do mug plug real quick. If you've been to more than 10 1 million cups, raise your hand. If you already have one of these mugs, put your hand down. You don't have this one? All right. I'm going to go over here. Introduce yourself and tell us why you come to 1 Million Cups.
Hi, my name is Beck Johnson. I've been coming to 1 Million Cups for a couple of years now, and I come because I love Kansas City and the surrounding area, and I love seeing all the entrepreneurship and creativity and just seeing the region grow.
All right, a couple quick announcements. One is for the launch code. In case you didn't know, we push these all out through the 1 Million Cups app. So if you guys didn't know, you can check it on the app. You can see who's here. You can rate the presenters. You can also get our announcements. So launch code first anniversary party is tomorrow at 5:30 at Counterpoint. So check that out. And then we also have the digital sandbox next week, how to pitch to the sandbox. Yeah, right? You want to talk about it real quick? I pitched a digital sandbox and got it, so it was very much worth it. I highly suggest checking that out. And then lastly, our last presenter was not able to make it today, last minute. So being a bunch of entrepreneurs, we're pivoting, and we're going to have a great panel of women, entrepreneurs and founders, including, Kate, our very own Casey Saunders. Let's hear it for her. Adrian Haynes and Connor Hazelrig. All right, come on up. And who's going to be talking immediately? All right. Do you want just avoid the other mic? Mom Center probably has sick kids. Okay. So we're going to start with a couple minutes about your business. So just each one of you, if you'd like to talk for a couple minutes.
Hello. Okay, this is on. Hi, my name's Connor Hazerig. I'm the founder of 1773. We provide solar paneled cell phone chargers to developing nations to create jobs and help bridge the gap between those that depend on their cell phone every day for all of their needs, but don't have access to electricity.
Good morning and happy Women's History Month. My name is Adrienne Haynes. I am the managing partner of Seed Law, which is an entrepreneurial law firm here in Kansas City. I also have a consultancy and two nonprofits.
And my name is Casey Saunders. I am the CMO at Feudum. Feudum designs and develops omnidirectional proprietary fitness products. And in case you're wondering, Feudum stands for Everybody Who Doubts Me. It's a motivational concept that really kind of is the DNA behind what we do and our brand. So.
All right, I'm going to talk into something that should be on my shirt. I don't have anywhere to sit, so I'm going to stand here. So jumping in straight to, I think, the what we all know that is coming out of this conversation, what are the struggles, the trials, the tribulations that you've gone through as a female founder, as a female business leader, just high level? What are kind of the things you've run into that you've noticed most consistently?
If I can be really honest.
You can be. You're on the live stream, but you can be really honest.
I think... there is a bit, I see it changing, and obviously I'm new to this, I'm new to the business sector, but there is a part somewhat of a, it can be a boys club, it's hard for women to be taken as seriously as men are, it's hard for women to come to the table and have a conversation that is as serious as men can have, to penetrate some of those inner circles. On the whole, I think that obviously women can do anything that a woman can do anything that a man can do, and I haven't seen any specific any specific hurdles or obstacles that were put in front of me because I'm a woman, but it's just subtle things, little nuances that you pick up on as a woman, and I think that as we start to penetrate those circles and continue to grow our businesses and there's more and more women entrepreneurs, that will slowly, hopefully dissipate by the time my daughter grows up and is an entrepreneur. I
cannot wait till you have a daughter.
That's gonna be a day. Tommy and Casey have a daughter. I mean, that's like Beyonce having the twins,
Next level of Kansas City's entrepreneurs. I think an important part about doing anything that's adventurous is you believe you can do it when you see other people who look like you doing that. And so as a woman entrepreneur, I face the same hurdles that my male counterparts do. But I think one of the big differences is sometimes we see less representation of women really scaling and growing their business as well. But that's also why I'm glad we're highlighting women entrepreneurs during Women's History Month here. And I think there are some really, really strong organizations in KC that help to create those communities. But I think that that's one of the biggest challenges is really having to intentionally seek out environments where I'm surrounded by really powerful women. Which we exist, but another thing about women is most of us, if something has to be done, we do it. Yeah. So sometimes you're just closing the door, you're working in that silo, and you're getting it done, but we just need to remember that we also need one another. So I think that's one of the biggest challenges.
That's a good answer.
I mean, really just to kind of reflect on everything they said, I mean, the only thing that I've found growing up in my boys club of owning a business is the doubt. When I've traveled overseas and started to implement my product into different villages, they always ask, who built it? Because there's typically guys and girls in the groups that go with me, and they say, well, which one of these guys built it? And it's like, no, I did. I designed it. Because it's a piece of technology, because it actually requires fabrication of metal and welding and wires and all sorts of other technical aspects, there's doubt that why would a woman build it? How does a woman get the knowledge to build it? And so that's kind of been one of the biggest things that I've had to face, but it's not an obstacle. It's just something that gets to be overcome and proves that women can do things all around the world.
That's beautiful, Connor. Just for the record, that is beautiful. yeah, there it is. I feel like you, at least once a day, you deserve a round of applause. So we just
absolutely
made that happen
not
here.
Absolutely not.
So kind of in the vein of building a
a conducive atmosphere for you to grow as a business leader or as an entrepreneur, whatever the vein is there. How have you gone about finding that? I mean, is it, you know, finding mentors? Is that really important to you? Is it really just doing it, proving it to yourself, and then keeping going? Like, what is the thing that makes that atmosphere conducive for you guys? Girls, ladies,
okay,
women.
I'll go first.
Y'all, for y'all.
All right, I guess I'm not new, or I guess I'm new at this panel thing on who starts. So, I mean, for me, throughout this year, meaning we're only 2 months in, and to go forward with my goals for my company, I've built a team of mentors, and I was speaking to some students at UMKC a couple weeks ago, and I told them maybe I went overboard because I got 9. So I've got quite a few mentors, but each one of them serves a different purpose for some of the things that I have to accomplish to run a business that is overseas and it works in different countries that are completely different. Sales aren't always the same for different countries because of the cultural differences. And even working with organizations here in the United States, everything's different. And so I'm very much a doer. When I see an obstacle, I just have to go out and, you know, overcome it. And then whether it's attracting 3 or 4 people to help me do so, that's just what I have to do. I love meeting up with people and friends and all of that. People like on both sides of me here to talk through problems because their ideas help me see things that I wouldn't necessarily be able to see. And so surrounding myself with people that are here today is what helps me create that environment that makes me feel motivated to go work harder than I can, you know, yesterday or I want to the next day. So
if you're not careful, you're about to get another round of applause, just for the record. Just watch out.
Well deserved. Well deserved. I think that's a really good point, surrounding yourself with people that are different than you and smarter than you. As our previous presenter said, she doesn't have a lot of lawyer friends. I have a lot of lawyer friends, so I have to find people who can make hemp bracelets. You know, it's important for me to diversify as well. And I have been really fortunate. I'm not from Kansas City. I've been here 7 years this year, and it is fully home now, but I have been able to find some partners who just believe in the things that I'm saying and actually challenge me to accomplish them. So I had the great privilege of designing and running the Blue Hills Contractor Incubator, a construction incubator here in Kansas City. And the way we were able to do that was many hands makes light work. So we had a ton of really passionate people come together, and then we really listened to what our business owners wanted. And that's, I think, what's been really helpful in my companies, even in the law firm, as a businesswoman turned lawyer, then turned entrepreneurial lawyer, just making sure that I'm still putting myself in situations where I'm listening to what people really need and really just trying to find a direct path to a solution.
I think because both of you touched on us having mentors, I think obviously that's extremely important, but as entrepreneurs, sometimes we have tunnel vision and we're looking down at our work and we're looking for opportunities for someone else to help us, which is an amazing thing. You know, when we all get together, we do think bigger, better things together. But I've found recently that I've grown more helping other people. So getting back into the community, and there are young women who are entrepreneurial themselves, and me just lending what may seem to me not like a lot of experience, but for them it's very helpful, and seeing their passion and seeing their information and the things that they're learning reflected back to me is kind of another way to kind of get that growth, to gain that that growth that you would get from another mentor who's maybe more experienced than we are. So kind of going at it from both directions is important. What's up, Zach?
Well, I got one left from myself before I toss it over to the expert panel and then the crowd. So I'm very aware of the fact that I won the genetic lottery. I'm over 6 foot, I'm a white male, and you know, all that.
Awesome.
So what are the things? And yeah, clearly. you know me that well, Melissa. But I am very clear on the fact that I would not probably be in a lot of the positions that I am in my life if it weren't for that. I mean, there's a lot of unconscious bias that goes into that as to why I'm pulled into rooms that I'm pulled into and certain people aren't, so on and so forth. So being in the position you're in, what is the thing that you wish people were paying more attention to on the side of unconscious bias or on the side of kind of that side of things? So basically, I'm just giving you a chance to get up on your soapbox a little bit and tell me what you wish I was doing better. And like me as males.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's a heavy question.
Yeah, I wasn't trying to give you a softball.
That is heavy. but I think I can do it. I just think having more conversations and actually paying attention to the fact that we thrive and we grow when there are voices in the room that have different paths, that have different ethnicities, that are of different genders, because everyone has something to add to the conversation and has something to add to the business or whatever it may be. Just number one, being aware. I think sometimes people take for granted, and I don't want to point you out, Zach, but I mean, there is a tendency sometimes for white males or white women to go into a room and maybe not see that there is a lack of diversity. And I think sometimes minorities come into the room and they see that. That's something that we look around and say, okay, there's not a lot of people that look like me. Mm-hmm. That's not the case, you know, the other way around. So just looking for opportunities to bring more people into the room and saying, hey, this room looks a little, you know, there's more like 70% of, you know, one race in this room. Let's try to diversify it and engage more people. So honestly, just being aware of it, I think, is step number one. Adrian?
That's a great question. So one of the nonprofits that I have the great privilege of working with is the Multicultural Business Coalition here in Kansas City. We have now hosted 3 very successful multicultural business happy hours, and it's a collective of about 27 of the organizations in Kansas City that were designed to serve a diverse business community. So we have the Hispanic Chamber, the Asian Chamber, the Black Chamber, and really all of the subgroups. So those organizations here in KC that were designed to make sure that people feel included. And one of the interesting things for me when we're talking about what can we as a community do to be more mindful, and I'm going to piggyback on what you said, Casey, when we have programs and initiatives or events, everyone should be walking in saying, what does this look like? Does this room look like what our community looks like? And does our entrepreneurial community look like what our community looks like? The incubator I mentioned is on 50th and Prospect. We are firmly in
drop
the urban
name.
Core.
Blue Hills,
yeah,
drop
Blue
it.
Blue Hills Contractor Incubator. It's over there. It's the bright orange building. Once you see it, you can't unsee it. But I mean, we really worked hard there to make sure that it was inclusive. But because of that, the benefits that we reaped were jobs created, businesses growing. Actually, we were able to see employees start to think more entrepreneurial too. I mean, the benefits were endless, but what I say that to say, as a community, we have to be mindful. As people who put on programming, we have to be mindful. As entrepreneurs in our own businesses, we have to be mindful. And I'm not only talking, do we have 1 black person in the room, 2 black people, 3 Hispanics? It's about diversity of ideas as well, and backgrounds, and expertise, and faiths. It takes a village. Mm-hmm. And I think as an entrepreneurial community, we can all be a little bit more mindful of that.
So a comment someone told me one time, and I'll keep it PG because we are live streaming.
Indeed.
But
thank you.
Our last presenter
could probably
put this on the next hand towel. the explicit version, of course, is that the more male body parts you put into a discussion, the more problems you're going to have.
I'm going to get another round of applause in a minute if you're not careful.
Well, this looks male heavy here, so I don't know if I will.
They feel uncomfortable, so they'll just start clapping. They don't know what else to do. They're like, No, it is a diverse group. It is a diverse group, but go ahead.
So, and I mean, it's just very true to how, you know, kind of what Casey said, that most of these discussions are in boys' clubs. You know, to find, and this is very true for how I've gone about solving problems with my business and how our product has been created, is that you find the answer to problems within the people that experience it the most. And so if a group of people are, you know, kind of what Adrian was talking about, or of one group that never experienced the problem, then you're never going to find the true solution. And the more you push your solution onto other people, the less it's going to have an impact, the less it's going to be adopted. And so to get not just women, but people of different races and faiths and everything, you know, the more that you're going to be able to get that aspect to solve everyday issues that, you know, seem like small things, but a woman might see it differently than a man. A black person might see it different than a white person or a Latino person. And so to get that culture developed in every organization is so fundamental to solving problems. So
Well, I really appreciate all three of your candor, very much so. And I want to pass it over to our expert panel. Move it along.
I just wanted to, so I have a good example. So I had an aha moment just a few years ago, and this is really interesting because even though I run an angel group of women, most of investors and finance folks are men. I spend most of the time there. But about a few years ago, I was actually at an angel conference out in San Francisco, and somebody said, you know, companies that are run by both men and women, as well as companies that are invested in by both men and women, do so much better. And I'm sitting there thinking to myself, well, duh, but I never thought of that, okay? And it's true. It's those different perspectives. There's a lot of times guys will come to us and say, I want to pitch this idea in front. They maybe have a product that's very focused on, they're selling to women. And they say, I want to pitch in front of WCC. And I'm like, well, where's the woman on your management team? Oh, well, oh, my wife, she really does a lot of work. I'm like, no, that's not what we're looking for. So it's like, it's those different perspectives. And I was very fortunate to grow up with a dad who's like the true alpha male type, ran a bunch of companies. You know, played football, the whole big thing. And you know what? I'm an only child, and he never one minute made me think that he wished he had a boy, ever, ever. Like, he wasn't like, rah, rah, you can do anything you want to do. It's like, you got to work hard. But he never, ever treated me that way. And I think each generation is doing different and better with both gender and race and everything. I have two daughters that are 23 and 19. I don't think they see it. I don't think they care. You know, I remember one day my 23-year-old was describing, she's like, oh, you know him, you know that guy, you know, and she's telling me something, and I said, is he that tall black guy? And she goes, yeah, he is black. You know, really, like, she didn't even, that wasn't like how she, you know, I just was trying to, you know, identify who that was, and she's just like, I don't think they see it. I think we're better than our parents were. I think our kids are a whole lot better than us. So I think it's getting a lot better. I just, again, maybe it's, you say awareness and all that. I think maybe it's just, I just go into a room and talk to people, right? I mean, they're just people. So anyway, I don't know.
Okay, so I don't have quite as good of a story. But the thing that I always notice about women in these situations where you're put in a position of leadership, right? Like, you're asked to speak about your own experience, especially young women like us, have a tendency to talk about your mentors and talk about the people that have helped you, because we naturally work collaboratively. And, like, of course, every woman is a different human being, and so, like, we don't all think or work the same way. Just like human beings think and work differently. Newsflash. That's my little soapbox. But the one thing I would love to know is, when you're living into your role as a leader in this community, when you're setting that example for other people who are looking up to you, and Casey, you mentioned the people that you act as a mentor for yourself, what kind of behavior are you modeling? What do you hope people see in the way that you treat the people around you?
So I get to start because I have the microphone. So one of the things that I've always tried to brand myself on is authenticity. I come from a family that has quite a bit of wealth status. I went to a private school that cost a fortune. And I've never wanted that to reflect who I am and what my values are. And so to very much show the authentic passion for helping people in developing nations is always what I've, you know, been able to use for myself and in what I want other people to see me as being a problem solver, as having authentic passion for what I do and caring for the people that I don't know, but I know I can help. So that's kind of been my ground for where I am.
When I'm working with people, I also have the great privilege of being able to mentor and coach other businesses here in Kansas City. And what I try to communicate through my actions is, number one, a sense of hope. I think in an entrepreneurial community, there has to be hope that the crazy ideas that we come up with, the solutions that we feel like we can provide to our communities and our world are possible and possible together. So hope. And then also the togetherness. Collaboration is currency. Yes, we all work with mentors. We have been mentors. But I couldn't do any of this by myself, and I really wouldn't want to. And then also the inclusion, making sure that the people that you're making decisions for are at the table. In all situations. I don't want to make decisions for a group of people or a characteristic of people without hearing their input. So really just listening, that critical listening.
For me, I think I just really try to be approachable because I think it's difficult, even if I see another woman who's in business, but I feel that I can't approach her to ask her questions or lean on her for, you know, a connection that I need, then it's not really that helpful to me. So I always try to project an openness that you can come talk to me. You know, I'm willing to help you with whatever issue you have going on. I really feel that that's important because, like I said before, if I have resources available to me but I'm uncomfortable to ask for those, then it's not as helpful as it could be. So it's really important for all of us to see, okay, how am I standing? How am I looking at the people in the room and seeing who I feel like could be helpful to me? Am I listening to people's conversation and finding a way to interject and say, hey, I have a resource for you, or have you thought about this? It's our job as mentors to be looking for mentees. Is that the right word? Is it mentees? Okay. It's our job to be looking for them as well, you know? If we want to be, if we want to be helpful, if we want to be effective, so is that the right word? Were you guys talking about that? Okay, so yeah, that's it.
Okay, we're going to open it up. We have time for a couple questions for the audience. Anyone have a question for these wonderful women? Anyone? No one?
Oh, got one right there.
Oh, okay,
couple.
Okay, I think this question is hard because I can't figure it out, and I never go to these things, and Greg's a new person, so I came with him, and this is the best one for me to be at because you can answer my question. Okay, maybe. So I'm a woman business owner, and I have a business partner who is a woman as well, and the old boys club thing, I didn't really believe until I became a business owner, right? Like, they make jokes about it on TV and stuff, but I didn't think that was a thing until we sat down with our very first potential client, who made a lot of comments about, maybe as women you'll be able to do this, I don't know, da da da. And at that point I was very like pro women, and we turned him down, which was very hard to turn $12,000 down when you start a business and I'm a single mom, and you know, but I was gonna stick to my morals and values. Well, what I've learned over time is that my morals and values are gonna make me go broke if I continue to turn down every single person that's gonna make the comments that are very not PC, that are very, you know, even the backhanded comments, like, you guys have done very well for women and stuff like that. Like, that is very tough, right? We are in a service industry, so you run into it quite a bit. So how do you guys handle, or how would you handle, when you're sitting in front of those decision makers that are, you know, very huge contracts, but they make those comments that probably aren't the most PC, probably aren't the most comfortable, where you want your morals and values to really get up and walk out, but you're sitting down there in front of a $25,000 contract. How do you guys handle that? Because that's what I'm going to do.
I think humor, yeah, it is a really good question, and it's difficult. It's different for everyone. Humor is one way for me to get at it. You know, you don't have to be confrontational. You can kind of make a joke if you wanted to, but for me, success is the best revenge. So if you can just push past that, make a joke, brush it off, because that's enough to stop some people, you know? We're gonna face a lot of adversity trying to get, any of us will, but as women, we face a little bit of adversity trying to get where we wanna go. So shrug it off and be successful anyways. You know, I can understand saying, I don't feel comfortable working with this person because I don't believe what that person believes. That's your, you know, that's your prerogative. You should do that when you feel it's appropriate, but taking that business and then showing them being successful and then showing them, hey, this isn't just, I'm not a one-off. Women can really be successful. We can do what we say we're going to do. We can do as much as men can do. So just finding a balance between, you know, standing your ground and saying, hey, this person's way out of line, and then also just showing them through experience, or giving them the experience with more women that, you know, we're not, like I said, one-offs. Adrian.
So in listening to your story, as a Black female business owner, I had to think about whether or not I've had any clients have those comments when it's time to sign the engagement letter. And I realized gratefully that I haven't. And I think why that is because, first, I'm okay with firing a client. I mean, we do things different at my law firm. We are working together. And if you're not down with the way we do things, there's plenty of other law firms. But then also, qualifying leads is really important. So by the time I get someone to the point where they're ready to sign their check, which is one of my favorite moments, by the way, and when they're ready to sign their engagement letter, we already have a relationship at that point. We already have a rapport. So it's very rare that I get surprise comments like that at the end. So I would encourage you, and happy to work with you, to talk through, like, who is an ideal client for us? Who are we looking to serve? Where do they hang out? How can we find them? And how can we make sure when we get to the point we're not surprised at a comment that's offensive? Because as a business owner, I know what it's like to work with a client that you don't necessarily want to be best friends with. That can be tough. But I try as hard as I can to get that figured out before we actually begin the client relationship. So happy to chat about that after.
Yeah, absolutely. Relationships are the most important. And so For my customers, most of them are church organizations, and I don't have the same fundamental beliefs that most church organizations do, and so I face that a lot. Now, the comments aren't necessarily there, but you can feel the tension when working with people because they make assumptions, or they say and portray different things. They want you to come to church services, and I'm happy to do that, but then there's also this, we need to connect so that it's not just based on our beliefs, but on our goal for what we want to do together. And so very much have to keep that professionalism route just to stay away from any sort of political aspects, because relationships can flip very quickly with your customers because you want to stay customer service oriented. So, yeah.
Guys, give these ladies a round of applause, please. Thank you so much. She said no more rounds of applause, but we had to.
That was for these two.
Thank you. Next week, we are going to be back in the auditorium on the other side, so definitely join us. We have two presenters next week, Be Organized and We Go Trips, so make sure you join us. Have a good one, guys.